What you have to do here, which concept you have to use?
So I say D.
D for Delhi?
Yes, sir.
Correct. Work energy theorem you have to use. And D is the correct answer here.
Yes, sir.
So work done is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. So W is zero. All right. And let's say this horizontal level is zero potential energy. Small object, why it is given small object? It rolls up the curve. So this is small object. So you can ignore this radius compared to the ramp it is taking. Otherwise, the potential, there is initial potential energy, which is MGR. Okay. So you can ignore MGR potential energy. Center of mass is above the surface of by a distance of R. So you can say that approximately initial potential energy is zero. Initial kinetic energy, you can write it as half m into vcm square plus half icm into omega square. Okay. And then its potential energy, that you can write it as mgh, where h is given as 3v square by 4g. So this is 3v square by 4g. Okay. And k2. Okay, K2 is zero. It comes to rest at the highest point. Yes or no? So also, omega is equal to VCM by R, since there is a pair rolling that is going on. Fine. So when you substitute all of this, you will get a moment of inertia about center of mass to be equal to MR square by 2. And that is true. That is true for the disk only. Fine. This came in year 2007. Should I move to next? Any doubts on this? Please quickly ask. Oh, let me find out some of the latest ones. Anyone got the answer? This doesn't look to be from rigid body motion, but then we should not hesitate to take any other chapter's question also, since now is towards the fag end of your preparation. Okay, Kushal saying D, Sundar is saying D. Others? No one is getting answer other than these two.
So one second
is over. Okay, so let's see. Acha, first of all, what is the velocity? What should be the velocity for it to reach B? How much that should be equal to reach B? We have done this in work energy chapter, under root 5GL. Okay. So the velocity should be equal to root 5GL for it to complete the vertical circle. Okay. Now we are giving the speed, which is half the angle theta at which the speed of the bob is half to that of A. Okay, you need to find out where is a point where the velocity becomes, if this is V1, the velocity should become under root 5GL by 2. So where is that point? Okay, so simply you have to use work energy theorem. Work done is U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay, so W is zero. You can say that this line represents zero gravitational potential energy, that red line. Okay, so U2 is what? Mg into this distance, which is equal to what? This distance is equal to r minus r cos theta, because this distance is r cos theta and total distance from here is r. So r minus r cos theta. So this is equal to mg r 1 minus cos theta is u2. Plus k2 is what? Half m into v2 square. V2 is this. All right. Minus u1. U1 is 0 to begin with. Plus half m into v1 square, where v1 is this. So from here you get some value of cos theta. Okay. For here, you'll get some value of cos theta, and then Shweta, see, you might have got under root 5GL by assuming that it at point B the velocity becomes zero. Okay, so when it is moving in a vertical circle and it has to reach B, then velocity at point B cannot be zero. Okay, if you assume velocity to be zero there, then you get initial velocity to be under root 4GL. Okay, but if it has to move in a circle, then you know, the velocity should be such at point B that tension becomes just zero over there. Otherwise, you know what will happen is this. After a point, it will start moving in a parabola, okay? And then it will move something like this and may fall like that. So even this point is also at a distance of 2R only, okay? But this is not point B. Here, velocity is zero because the string became slack. But if to ensure that it goes to the point B, okay, then it should move in a circle. Go back and revisit that vertical circular motion that we have done in class 11th. Okay, the tension just becomes zero over there. Okay, so that's how you get under root 5GL, and just revisit that once. Okay. Here is the next question. This came in JEE Mains 2013. Okay, Sundar is saying C, Sai Premnath saying A. Others? Sai Mihir is saying A. Okay, now which concept should we use here? See, ultimately when the object starts rolling, you know, when the object starts rolling, then V center of mass should become equal to omega r, because let's say there is this hoop. Okay, so if it has to perform pure rolling, okay, then this point of contact should be at the rest. Okay, so with respect to center of mass, suppose the angular velocity is like this. Okay, so with respect to center of mass, the backside, the velocity is omega into r. Okay, and since it is moving forward with vcm velocity, the total velocity will be omega r and VCM combined. So net net velocity will be VCM minus omega r. Okay, when this become equal to zero, then it means that there is no slipping. Okay, so this is the no slipping criteria where VCM should become equal to omega into r. Okay, now you can solve this question in different ways. Okay, one of the obvious ways is just use that basic, as in there are forces like mg. Okay, this is mg force, and then there is a normal reaction from this surface like this, and then there will be a friction force. Let us say that friction force is fr. Okay, and till the point this object starts pure rolling, it is a sliding friction or kinetic friction, so the friction value remains constant. Okay, after it starts rolling, then it becomes static friction. Okay, and also I'm just randomly telling you these facts that few of the things, like if the object is pure, it is doing pure rolling, the work done by the friction you should take always to be zero, because that is static friction and the point of contact is at rest. Okay, so never take work done by friction if object is pure rolling, but here it is not pure rolling. Okay, all right, so the total force is what? Total force on this hoop is fr only. Okay, so acceleration is what? Friction force divided by mass. All right, so velocity after time t, okay, is u plus at, initial velocity is zero, plus fr t divided by m. Okay, see, basically what I'm doing here is I am assuming that it has been given a angular velocity like this. Okay, so it is, this point is slipping right now. Okay, so velocity along this direction horizontally that will be created by this force will be equal to this. Yes or no? Any doubt on this? And friction into r is a torque about the center of mass. No other force creates a torque about center of mass. Only mg and normal reaction are the other forces, and for those forces about center of mass, the torque is zero. So fr into r is the torque due to friction. This is equal to moment of inertia, which is mr square by 2 into alpha, I alpha. Okay, so the angular velocity alpha will become equal to 2 fr divided by m into r. All right, so this is alpha, so the angular velocity will be equal to omega naught, which is the initial angular velocity, minus alpha into t. See, the angular acceleration due to the friction is opposite direction of angular velocity. Angular velocity is like this, but alpha is in opposite direction. So that is why omega naught minus alpha into t. Okay, so this is omega after time t, and this is velocity after time t. Okay, so if this has to start the pure rolling, then v should be equal to omega into r. So basically frt by m should be equal to omega into r, or that is equal to omega naught r minus 2 frt by m. Okay, so from here you get t. All right, from this equation you'll get the value of t, and then what to find out? You need to find out the velocity, right? So then you substitute that value of t over here, you get the value of velocity. Okay, so this is one way to solve. This is like the more conventional way and the more obvious way how you can approach this question. Other way is to use conservation of angular momentum. Okay, so you can conserve momentum about this axis. All right, So let me show you how you can do that. So initial angular momentum, when it is just sliding, when it is just rotating, is ICM into omega, okay, about this point, because it is not going anywhere. So VCM is zero initially. So ICM into omega is the initial angular momentum. This will be equal to the final angular momentum, which is R cross MV. So M into VCM into R plus, you get ICM into omega dash, and omega dash is equal to VCM into R. Okay, so you can write down omega dash as VCM divided by R. So from here you get the value of VCM. Okay, so like this also you can get the value of velocity by just using conservation of angular momentum, right? Any doubt on this particular question? Those who have solved some questions on this chapter might be knowing that these are like routine ones. I think you will encounter such question during your practice also. There are a couple of them like this in HC Verma as well. Okay, do this one. Anybody is able to get the answer? 33. No, it is not D. Others? Okay, Purik is getting A, that is correct. Sai is getting each and every answer correct. Huh? Good. I hope you repeat this performance in test also. Okay, so let's see how we can solve this particular question. So we have a solid sphere. Okay, so on the solid sphere of mass m and radius r, a cube of maximum possible volume is cut. Okay, so cube of maximum possible volume is cut. So if you look from the front, it will look like a square to you. Okay, and hence you'll be able to calculate the side length. How much you got the side length as? So if you look from diagonal to diagonal, this point to that point, how much is this distance? If let's say the side length of the cube is A, how much is this distance, this diagonal?
So it'll be root 3a.
Root 3a, correct. So it's not a two-dimensional thing, all right? So this is not root 2a. This is root 3a. Getting it? So it's a three-dimensional figure. This is a cube. It's not a square, actually. It looks like a square when you look from the front. But this is one point, one end of the diagonal to the other end of the diagonal. It's a major diagonal of the cube. Okay. So this root 3a should be equal to 2 times r. Fine. So the side length of the cube will be 2r by root 3. Okay. Now we know that moment of inertia of a cube, do you know it is ma square by 6 about the center of mass?
Yes.
Right. Now m is what? The mass of the cube. All right, this is not same as the mass which is given over here. This is different mass. This is what? The sphere's mass. So let's say this is m dash. So you need to find m dash in terms of m. You already got the value of a in terms of r. So now try to find m dash in terms of m. How will you find out? You can assume that the mass is uniformly distributed over the volume. Okay, so the ratio of mass m by m dash is same as ratio of the volume. Is this something which is reasonable?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So V is the volume of the sphere, which is what? 4 by 3. pi r cube, okay, divided by volume of the cube, which is a cube only. All right. So just substitute the values of, you can substitute value of a, you'll get m by m dash, and from here you get m dash in terms of m, and then substitute here. Okay, and you'll get option A to be correct. All right, so you can see that here, more than physics, it is about how you think or how you break down a problem. That is what is tested here. It's not about reading the theory or reading the concept again and again. It's at times about opening up your mind and thinking freely. Okay, so you have to develop that. Okay, so that will get developed only when you take lots and lots of tests. When you take the test with time constraint, you will first of all get to know there are many, many varieties of the question, and you will know how to think then and there and get the answer. Okay, initially you will not be able to solve many questions correctly like this, but slowly and slowly, when you are getting accustomed to that kind of rigor, you will be able to get even these kind of questions correct easily. But then these questions cannot be, you will not be able to solve this by just, revising the same thing again and again and trying to finish up something. I mean, just for your own satisfaction, like, so just to satisfy yourself, or just to feel good that, okay, I have completed something and moving ahead. You know, all that doesn't matter, you know. So whenever there's a test, there's a mock test, take it. It doesn't matter whether you have finished the syllabus or not, because anyway, you're not aiming for 100% marks. Nobody gets 100% marks. There rarely it happens. Okay. So if 100% marks are not even possible, you are aiming for 60% marks, then what is the logic of finishing the syllabus and then writing a mock test doesn't apply.